Hello guys, Sharif sir here. Thank you so much for 400 plus subscribers and good to see that many students are benefiting from our YouTube channel. And this is to introduce a new video playlist that is covering full lessons. So I'm really happy to introduce you guys this series, and also I hope many students will benefit from this all over the country, right? So these are basically lessons from our Zoom class, so I'm planning to upload them from time to time. So today we're going to start with lesson number 4 from grade 10. And guys, I want to update you on our Zoom classes, which is on Thursday from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. and the seats are very limited. So if you want to join that class, please drop me a message through WhatsApp, okay? And also we are going to start a brand new class for grade 10 students on the first week of August. If you are willing to register to that class, please drop me a message with your name, your school and your city, alright? So if you have any questions, you have my number, feel free to call me anytime, alright? So enjoy the video. This is so important, this lesson. You know why? Because there are a lot of singular words in this lesson that you have to remember. They expect you to remember. Most probably, you know, there won't be many essay questions from this unit, but MCQ questions and also short questions, short type, you know, short essay questions. Let's say in question number one, you have a small part with 4 short questions, maybe that, or maybe the first 2 parts of a written question. Okay, so those 2 are like 3 marks and 4 marks allocated to the first 2 parts, right? So I expect those type of questions covering this unit, okay? Short questions or MCQ questions. But this lesson is very, very important because this lesson has a very important map. That's in page number 52, like we discussed last week, right? So guys, I want you to write down all these words right now. Extensively we discuss, then we have sabhav, mahali, or both are same, okay? We'll discuss them later. Okay, let's have a subtopic here, guys. So words related to administration, words related to healthcare. So I'm categorizing all these words, okay? So all you have to remember all these words, right? They expect you to remember all these words. This lesson is about those words, right? Nothing else, okay? All others you can think and write. You can think and make sentences once you know these words, okay? All 3 are same actually. So you can put slashes and write these 3, okay? Right. Then we have...
So that means together?
Yeah. So the 2 types of taxes charged by the government from the people who engaged in chenna cultivation was Kathiyada and Ketu Kanaba Aye. Now inside the meaning, Ketu means the tilling, that feeling is there. Kotanawa kiyana feeling, okay? Kotanawa kiyana e theruma. So Kathi means, you know, the Kathi means normally when you clear the tool that is used to clear the bushes and everything, like the big knife, okay? So Kathi Ada and Ketu Kanaba Aya, right? Those are the 2 types of taxes charged by the king Kumbura Keta. Sorry, 2 words, okay? Now let me brief you about this lesson later, right? Let's first learn all the important words and everything which comes in this lesson, right? Okay, over here in page number 45 you see a picture, right, with a few symbols. Basically this is an inscription. This is a photo from an inscription. You guys know what's an inscription, right? This was written in the 9th century AD, okay? Now each and every symbol here has a particular meaning to it. You have to remember the meanings of these symbols, okay? I will tell you what will come in this year's exam as well, don't worry. Right, so there will be an MCQ from this picture. So can you see there's a half moon sign, like a crescent sign on the top? Can you all see crescent mark at the top? Page number 45, figure 4.1. Are you following me, guys?
Yes, sir. Can see.
All right, you can see.
Yes.
So that means now, ara lassana sinduwak thiyena, you call it sandahiru taru pavatina turu api merenne na. Have you heard that song? Huh?
Yes, sir.
That song. Sandahiru taru pavatina turu. Ah, right. Okay, that means now this is eternal, right? Eternal means sadakalikai. Okay? It will never get destroyed. So to show that, you know, eternity, or you call it like, you know, that is basically that is the best word here, but they failed to mention that word here. So to mention the eternity or the continued existence, they have used this symbol. Okay, so that is the best example to show that nothing, you know, the moon will never get destroyed, or the moon will last until the earth lasts, something like that, right? So even the sun and the moon, yeah, they will never die. Okay, so that's called eternity. So this crescent mark symbolizes that whatever, you know, is written on the inscription, it is valid until the moon exists, right? So that means permanently. It's like a permanent feeling there. Okay, so look at this. The crescent mark at the top symbolizes that this allowance persist with you, something like that, right? So the second one, can you see? There's a vala oak creeper. Vala can you see that? Something like a rope, like a creeper design. This is called creeper. Can you see this design under the crescent sign? Can you see that combo wage thiyeneka katayam wage?
Yes,
can you all see that? Yeah. That is not the table tennis racket. Huh? Table tennis racket is under that. That's the fan, basically. That's not a table tennis racket. Okay. That's the fan, right? Okay. So before that, between the fan or the one that looks like a table tennis racket and the moon, right? You see that symbol, right? So that symbol is Vala Kid again, right? In Sinhala, you call it Liya Vala Kirakkin. Liya Vala. Basically, Vala. So, creeper. That indicates the swan. That shape is like a swan, hangse, swan. So swan is very, you know, white in color. Swan is the symbol of purity. Okay. Over here, the moon is the moon, or the sun is a symbol of eternity. And the swan is a symbol of purity. Right? Purity. So purity means valor or creeper. Purity. Okay, and the next one is fan. Okay, that's called the fan. In Sinhala, you call it Vatapatha. Okay, fan. Okay, so that's called the fan. That's the symbol of the royalty. Okay, royalty, Rajakiya. Royalty means Rajakiya. Okay, so that's about royalty. Okay, so let me go again. Crescent is the symbol of eternity. The creeper design, which indicates the swan, represents purity, and the fan, or which is called the Vatapatha in Sinhala, is the symbol of royalty. Okay. And the next one is the crow. Can you see that? Crow, and under the crow, there's a dog. Do you see them both? Dog and the crow. Can you see them? Tell me if you spotted them.
Yes.
Yeah. Crow is below the fan, and below the crow is the dog. Yeah, symbol of the dog, right? Don't mistake this for a lion. Okay, this is the dog, right? So that is a warning, basically. Okay, that is a warning. So let's say, for example, if you disturb this, or if you take anything from this, or if you destroyed this, right, this is a warning. Without any approval or without any order, if you disturb this, you will be born as a crow or a dog in your next life. So that's a warning. So those who are destroying this, or those who are going against the law, those who are going against what's written on this, those who disturb this, will be born as dogs and crows in the next life. So people didn't dare to touch those, right? So when it comes to the administration, these words are important. Ektan samiya sabhava mahale o mahale kam o mahale. Yeah? And the other one is dasa gam matta. Okay, very important, right? So ektan samiya means we discussed last week. That's basically the word used to call the executive and the legislature. Legislation means basically where the rules are made. So we learned that basically the king made the rules, and also he was the executive. He was the one who, who was the head of the country, and he's the one who controlled all these, you know, the judiciary, the court, and the legislature, the lawmaking, and everything was under him. So that's why we call it the executive, right? So he's got the powers, right? He was holding the highest position, right? So that is why we called it Ektan Samiya, okay? So, and the next one is Sabhava. So Ektan Samiya means, just write it down, Ektan Samiya, the word used to call the executive and the legislation. Sabhava means it's the council, basically the council where everybody sit. You can also call it a court, like those days. It's basically the judiciary, okay, like the council, right, where everybody sit and make decisions, collective, okay. So Sabhava is used to call the council or the judiciary. In some places, the word Sabhava was used to call the judiciary or the court system. Okay. So remember these things very well. Some words are used in different places, to call different things. Right? This you have to remember. Sabhava is a word like that. Basically, Sabhava means council. The meaning of Sabhava means council. Like Pradeshiya Sabhava. What is that? Today we have Pradeshiya Sabhava, Nagara Sabhava, right? It was an urban council. Yeah? Municipal council. Nagara Sabhava, Mahanagara Sabhava, like that. Do you want me to write? No need, right?
Okay.
You want me to write?
No need.
No need, right? Like this, yeah? Simple words, huh? Used to call the council or the judiciary. Simple, huh? Judiciary means basically the courts. Judges are there, right? Judiciary. Judicial proceedings. Can you court proceedings? Okay, related to law. Just use very short sentences. It's easy for you to remember. No need to write, long definitions for all this, right? Okay. Is everyone following me? All okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So next one is
yes,
Mahale.
Sir.
Mahale maha means big. Huh? Maha means big. Lokuma. First. Big. The biggest. Something like that. Maha means that. Okay. So what is Maha? Maha Mulakaru means what? Huh? Main planner. Pask Prahare Maha Mulakar. These days, we use that word, right? Maha Mulakar. Who is the Maha Mulakar? Is it Zaharan or is it someone else? Or is it a politician? Is it, maybe... a foreign terrorist organization. Maha means that big one, right? So the big brain behind it, the main guy behind it. So Mahale means not blood. Huh? Mahale means it came from Mahalekaka or Mahalekam. So he is basically the chief secretary. Okay. Chief secretary means who? He is in charge of all the administration, all the documents and everything. Right, so that's why he was called secretary. So Mahalekam or Mahale or Mahalekaka. Mahalekaka means great writer. Like, it's not like that. I mean, his work is writing. Writing what? Writing the law. Not like writing poems and everything. Okay. Writing the law, writing king's orders. So this was performed by the secretary, the general secretary or the chief secretary. Okay. Chief secretary or the general secretary. So he was called Mahale or Mahalekam. Okay. Mahalekaka is also could be used. I'm just writing this here. Mahalekaka. So when you see these words, you have to understand that this is about the general secretary. Okay. This is about Mahalekam. Oh, general secretary, who's basically in charge of, you know, a lot of administrative affairs. So over here, you can go to page number 45 in the book. See, the duty of the secretaries of the government was to document all governmental affairs and take necessary steps to preserve them. Like he was in charge of all the documents, right? Writing and preserving or storing those documents, right? So he's the one responsible.
Sir, yeah. At this age also they use olaleus, right?
Some people use olaleus, yes. Still they use olaleus. But I don't understand the point here because maybe as a tradition, but you don't need to, right? Because we have computers, we have good books. You write these guys? Mahale means used to call the general secretary, right? Oh, sometimes there's another connection here. Instead of Sabhava, they have used Mahale in some places, in some texts, right? If you go to page number 45, you just read that and try to understand the connection between Mahale and Sabhava. Like in some places, they have used the word Mahale or Mahale Kaka in place of Sabhava. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Can you give a definition for Sabhava again?
Yeah, Sabhava is used to call the council or the judiciary. Now, these are the words that were used in ancient times, okay? To call or to name different functions and different things in the administration or the society itself, in the ancient society. So these are all ancient words, guys. Today, we are not using them. Some words are still there, like Mahalekam. Yeah, still there. Some words are still being used. But some words, Mahale, Sabhava is still being used. But Ektansami is not used anymore. So we have to understand that, right? These are ancient words. Okay. And the next one is Dasagam Attan. Dasa means 10. Gam means villages. Attan means, you know, mainly the in charges. Okay. So in charges of 10 villages. Now, you know that there was a big court, right? Okay, you can call it the Sabhava or Ektansamiya or yeah, something like that, right? So, you know, minor cases were there, right? Like matters that are related to the villagers that could be solved by the villagers themselves. So there were people called Dasagam Mattan. Dasagam Mattan. Who were they? Dasagam Mattan means now they also participated administrative affairs in a minor scale, small scale, okay? Small stuff were decided by them, right? So they were people representing 10 villages. Dasagam Mattan. Okay? So mainly 10 village heads will get together and solve problems, sit in a council like a small meeting, and then they will solve problems. So those people were called Dasagam Mattan. Okay, so used to call the heads of 10 villages. Dasagam Mattan is a word used to call the heads of 10 villages who participated in minor administrative affairs. Write this. Gayendranami, what sectan sami?
The word which is used for administration and legislation.
Executive and the legislature. Okay. Executive. Huh? Yeah, the word that is used to call the executive and the legislature. Okay. Legislature is where the laws are made, Right? Executive is the authority. Whether they decide, you know, the law is there. Law is made by the legislature. Executive is the one who decides whether to force the law or enforce the law or not. For example, it's you know, let me take a very simple example, right? Okay, now we have this pandemic, right? Now the law clearly states what are the steps that we have to take during a pandemic. But it is the duty of the president to decide whether to implement or whether to enforce or whether to bring that law and put it into force. Okay, for example, now the act which is called the Quarantine Act, Nirodhayana Panatha. Now today we have these lockdowns and travel restrictions as a result of that act. That act was introduced in 1895. 1895 or something like that, more than 125 years ago. But that law is there, okay? Law is written in the book. So that's the legislation, right? That's the legislation. Okay, now the president comes. Now he's the executive, okay? For example, the king. He decides, now, okay, there's a pandemic, people are dying, okay, what we have to do? Now the council will gather, right? The meeting, like, okay, people will gather, all the ministers and everybody will gather. Then the president will decide, or the executive will decide, okay, according to this law, let's implement or let's bring the curfew, quarantine curfew, Nirodhayana Andiriniti, or let's say travel restrictions. Everything is mentioned in that law. So, but earlier, in the earlier times, king is the one who made the law as well. Okay, so that is why we call it Ektan Samir. Okay, Ektan Samir. Used to call the legislature or the place where the laws are made, and also the executive where the laws are implemented. Okay, the authority where the laws are implemented. Executive means today, executive means Vidayake. Vidayake means you give the orders basically. So who's giving the order those days? King was the only one who gave the orders, huh? No one else. Okay, no one else, right? So that we have to remember. Ektan Sami is a word used to call that, right? Okay, so let's go to the next words. We were using words related to healthcare or maybe hospitals and medicine basically. Okay, so Vaidya Sala. Sala means the hall. Sala means basically the building. Okay, so Vaidya Sala means hospital basically. Vaidya Sala means hospitals. Then Vaidya means doctors. Vaidya. Today we call him Veda. Veda Mahatya. Today we call it Veda Mahatya. Even Ayurveda doctors, we call them Veda Mahatya, right? Veda. So Vaidya was the ancient word. To treat specific diseases, like, you know, when some diseases are like out of control, and to treat serious diseases, there were special hospitals. Like we have IDH hospital to treat infectious diseases like corona, right? Infectious Diseases Hospital, IDH. Like that, there were specialized hospitals those days as well. Okay? So they were called Upasagga Roganasa. Upasagga Roganasa. Okay? Roga means illness or disease. Roga. I think intensive, like the meaning of like intensive care, that meaning is there inside that. Okay? So Upasagga Roganasa. Specialist hospitals. Okay, remember very well. Can we write those now? Keep it simple, okay? Don't write very long sentences. Just try to keep it very simple.
Sir, can you write it? The definition?
Upasagga Roga Nasa. Used to call specialized hospitals. In the ancient times, specialized or special hospitals. Okay, keep it simple. Okay, no problem. Now look how developed our ancient society was, right? We had hospitals, Vaidya Sala. We had doctors, Vaidya, and we had Upasagga Roganasa, or specialist hospital to treat different types of diseases. like special hospitals, where the normal vajrasalas couldn't accommodate. Okay, where vajrasalas didn't have enough facilities to treat those patients, like who were suffering from, you know, serious diseases. Kings made special hospitals called upasargaroganas, and not only that, kings even built hospitals specialized for pregnant women. Like, you know, today we have Castle, right, and the Soisa in Colombo, specialized for, you know, they are called maternity hospitals, like, you know, specialized for pregnant women. And even after their children were born, they go there and, you know, to treat any like complications and everything. They are called specialist hospital. Now, children, there's a specialist hospital, like LRH, Late Regio Hospital. In Colombo, in Borella, you have this, right? Children's Hospital, which is also called Children's Hospital. So same like that. Today we have those, right, with the technology and everything. But look at our ancient society, right? We also had those in the ancient times. We had specialized hospitals to treat different diseases, and also we had separate hospitals to treat pregnant women or to give childbirth, okay? Those are called Paswanti Nama Sala. The next word is Paswanti Nama Sala, which was also called, they were also called at sometimes Timbirike. Both of them are used to call maternity hospital. This says maternal hospital, okay? But maternity hospital is a correct word to use, guys. In the book, it says maternal hospital. Maternal is a word that is you basically used to show a relationship from your mother's side, okay? So maternity is the correct medical word to use here, okay? Maternity hospital, okay? So that was another word, Sottisala. Have you heard this word, Sottisala? We call them Sotti, right? Basically, they are suffering from some illness or diseases. So Sotti, like that, right? So Sottisala, maybe that Sotti word, you know, comes from that. But Sottisala, yeah, Sottisala was also used to call maternity hospitals. And also, not only that, Sottisala was also used to call places where Brahmins' religious activities were held. Okay, you know who Brahmins are, right? Who are Brahmins? Basically, they are priests from a different faith. Mainly, you know, Brahmins were of Hindu faith. Okay? They were also they were spiritually very developed people. Right? Just type Brahmin and see. Okay? So, spiritually developed. They were mainly teachers and people like that. You know, of Hindu faith, right? Brahmins. Mainly they came from, yeah, India and, yeah. Because, you know, Hindu faith, yeah, that got developed in India. So, Brahmins, yeah. So, Sottisala is a word used by Brahmins to call places where they held religious activities and also to name the maternity hospitals. Now, this one you have to remember very well. Huh? Sottisala was used to name two, Sottisala was the same word that was used to name two places. Okay. So those are some of the very important words when it comes to the healthcare sector of the ancient society that you have to remember. Okay. Make sure you remember all these. Okay.
So can you give a definition for Sottisala again?
Used by Brahmins or buildings or religious activities were held. Also used to call maternity hospital. Take your time, okay, because this lesson is so important, right? But there are a lot of words that we have to take our time and remember these, because if we rush things here, you're not going to remember anything. So I have to make sure you guys, you know, follow me, right, when remembering all this, okay? So tell me, what is Timbirige, Gaindu? What's a Timbirige?
Used to call maternity hospital.
Yeah, maternity hospital. What is maternity hospital, Buddha?
Hospital related to for pregnant.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, hospitals dedicated for pregnant women to give childbirth, right? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Tihan, tell me, what's upasargaroganas? What is so special about that word, upasargaroganas?
Upasargarogana is Special hospital for.
Special hospitals to treat, special like maybe diseases or pandemics, something like that. That means normal hospitals cannot treat those patients. So then came the need for special hospitals like Upasaga Roganas. Okay, right. So what is a normal hospital, Rovindu? What's the normal hospital?
Vejjasala.
Vejjasala, yeah, Vejjasala.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Is Timbirige and Sotisala the same words? Similar words?
Which one? Timbirige.
Timbirige
Yeah.
and Sotisala?
Look, Uda, Pasvanti Nama Sala, Timbirige, Sotti Sala. All three words were used to call maternity hospitals. Okay? Right?
Right, sir.
Okay. But Sotti Sala was also used to name buildings that were used by Brahmins for religious activities. Okay, two uses there. And let's go to agriculture. What are the words we have put under agriculture? Who can tell me? Behind to tell me.
Tena, pitibin and sen together.
All three are same, okay? Hena or chena. Chena is the English word, remember very well. Chena is the English word, hena is the singular word, okay? So hena or chena, hena, hen govitan. Oh, hena kila kyanne? This is the same word for chena. Chena is the English word, hena is the singular word, okay? Right, so hena means mainly that's called dryland cultivation. Okay, where they chose a plot of land from the jungle and cultivated different types of crops. That is called hena or chena. Okay, so sometimes they were called in ancient sources, they were called sen or pitibim as well in inscriptions. Okay, all right, so let's write it this way. Let's write a little long definition here. So the oldest method of agriculture in the world is called chena cultivation. Okay, remember that very well. Okay, this is the oldest method of agriculture. Choosing a plot of land from the jungle, cleaning it, or cutting down the trees and cleaning it, setting fire to it, and cultivating crops in it. Right? That's called chena cultivation. Okay, this is called the oldest method of cultivation. Hena is the no common term. Even today you call it hena. Okay. Chena is the English word. Sen was used in Ummagga Jataka. Sen, ancient literary sources, right? Pitibim in inscriptions. Pitibim was used to name chenas in inscriptions. Okay. But all three are same. Right? Basically, hena or chenas. Go to page number 47. Under farming and agriculture, just read that paragraph for me, okay? Right, after we discuss this lesson, you have to read that and make a mind map from this lesson, okay? Next one is Navadali Hena, right?
Yes.
Navadali Hena. Navadali Hena. Now, there are two interpretations for this, okay? Nava. Nava means today we call it Navakilagani, new, right? Nava. But those days, there's an interpretation that nine. Because in this type of chainers, nine types of crops were grown. Okay, so we learn that later, right? Now we are focused on learning these words, remembering these words. Okay, now later when we discuss about these things, I don't have to explain you what these words are. So that is why I'm teaching you the words beforehand. Okay, so Nava Dali Hen. Dali means basically soot. When you burn something, what is remaining, you can call it Alu or Dali. Okay. Hena means we already discussed, right? So Navadali Hena means when a brand new plot of land is chosen from the jungle and cleaned and set fire, and then once the fire is settled, the ground is prepared by tilling, okay, by turning the soil upside down. Then what happens? Whatever the remaining, like the ashes and the soot from the trees, from the burnt trees, they get mixed with the soil and the soil becomes very fertile. Okay, fertile. You don't need poro or anything after that. All right, So that is called Navadali Hain, when a brand new plot of land is prepared for chaina cultivation. Right? That was called Navadali Hain. Okay. A new chain, which is basically a plot of land from the jungle cleared and set fire, is called Navadali Hain. Okay, so there are basically two interpretations for this Navadali Hain. Some people say that it's because it's very new, they are calling it Navadali Hain. Nava means new, right? Some people say no, because there are 9 types of crops that were grown when a new, brand new chain was prepared. Only 9 types of food were grown there at first. Okay, that is why they called it Navadali Hain. Different people used to tell different things. So, okay, we'll learn both of them. So, we are rich in our knowledge, right? Is it? You guys ready for January or March? You like it March?
March.
Yeah. You said March. March is better, right? Okay. So, you can buy some more time to study, right? Okay. Who's ready for January? No one is ready for January. Oh, come on. What's this? We used to have, you know, our exams in the first week of December. First week. First December, second December, like that. By 10th and 11th, yeah, exams are over. Yeah. So it's over soon means holiday is long. Do you want to know what I did after my O-levels, guys?
Yes.
I grew my hair. Yeah. And I learned to play the drums. I went to a music class, you know. You guys also can do whatever you like, okay? But dedicate yourself, like I'm telling grade 10s as well, huh? Gaindu and Bihandu as well. Just 1.5 years, guys. Dedicate yourselves. You can't have, you know, you can't afford to have Saturdays and Sundays these days, right? Now it's all online. So again, you have, you know, enough time. You're saving time on travel and everything, right? You don't have to get ready and go to a class. You know, getting ready, that time is saved, and you don't have like you don't have a traveling time. So actually you guys have more time now. So you guys must be like using that time to study well. I mean, you know, it took like more than an hour for me to go to school, getting ready and going to school, 2 hours. Then coming back home, 1.5 hours. I used to travel from Homagam to Colombo, right? So by train and by bus. Yeah. So look how much time we spent for all those. And now you guys are saving all that time, right? I mean, your productivity should increase. So reduce your time on your mobile phones and everything. You know, just a few months, right? After that, you do whatever you want. Okay. Make your parents proud, guys. You know, they're sacrificing a lot of things for you. So, yeah. Make sure you work hard, right? Achieve your dreams. That's the most important thing, right? All right. So, the next word is Dandu Vata. Am I right? Dandu Vata.
Sir, Kanatha.
Kanatha. Yeah. So, today we call Kanatha cemetery, right? But those days they used to call those chainas, which were readied to cultivate again after giving it up. Now what happened those days was, basically there was this jungle. There was this farmer living a little away from that jungle. Okay, you can't live near a jungle. Yeah, you will be attacked by the wild animals, right? So you live in the village. So you go to the jungle, okay, you select a plot of land, let's say like this, okay. Then you clean it, okay, you cut down all the small trees and bushes and everything. You flatten it, you clean it, you set fire to it, you prepare the land, then you grow crops, right? After some time, okay, once you harvest the crops, what they did was they abandon it, okay, they leave it. So that again the jungle will grow here. That now what is the next step? He will choose another plot of land. Okay, he won't choose the same plot of land. Okay, he will choose another plot somewhere, and then he will grow the next season. Okay, After some time now, again he will decide, okay, this is close to my house, so I'm gonna, grow this place again. So that is called khanat. Now once you prepared it, you can call it khanat. Okay. That is only in Anuradhapur, right? That's only in Anuradhapur. This is extra knowledge for you guys. Okay. So this is how it all worked. Okay. This is how chaina cultivation worked. Paddy cultivation is permanent. Okay, let's talk about that later. Right? Once when I start explaining the unit, I will teach you well. Okay. How paddy cultivation worked. So this is basically chaina cultivation. So this is a big jungle, and you just choose a plot of land and yeah. Okay, now that's a good approach to our next word, that is Danduvetta. So once this plot of land is cleared and cultivated, now you have to wait until the, crops ripe, and then you can harvest them, right? So you have to protect them because this is a jungle, right? There are elephants, there are boars or pigs, wild pigs, who will be very happy to come and eat all these crops when they just start growing, right? So you have to make sure the plot of land is protected. So that is where they use dandu or sticks, vata or fence, stick fence. So they used to put sticks like this and make a fence around the chain. Okay. So that's called dandu vata. Dandu means sticks. Dandu. Danda. Danda means stick. Dandu means sticks. Okay. Plural. Dandu. Dandu vata. So dandu vata was built to protect the chain from wild animals. Okay, so they come, especially the wild animals are active at night. Remember that very well. Wild animals are active at night. So you have to guard the chain as well. So there were these big trees. Big trees were not cleared. Big trees were not cut when preparing chain lands. Remember that very well. So big trees are used as, watch stations or watch huts. Tree houses or watch huts, right? So these huts were called pala. Now you have to keep guard, right? Why do you have to like climb on a big tree and make a tree house? Because you can see all around. And also, even if the animals come, even if you fall asleep accidentally, right? Animals won't come and hurt you, right? You are way high up, right? They can't climb trees. And elephants and all, they can't climb trees. So they chose a big tree. And this is how they guarded the chain from wild animals. Okay, when animals come, they can shout and chase them. That's how it is. So Danduvetta is to protect the chain from animals. Even if the Danduvetta was destroyed by especially like elephants and all, they can chase them by guarding from the watch huts, right? Pala. That watch hut is called pala. Okay, the small hut built at the top of the tall tree in chain called pala. Okay. So what the farmers do is like they spend the whole night guarding the chain. You can imagine how difficult it was, right, to protect the crops from animal attacks. So they were called pala. Okay, all right. So Danduvetta is a stick fence. Okay, let's write it this way. Danduvetta stick fence built around chainers. Oh, heinous, huh? To protect them from wild animals. Next one is Kathi Adda and Ketu Kanab Ayer. Kathi Adda. Okay. Kathi Adda and Ketu Kanab Ayer. Right. Those two words, those two types, those are two types of taxes. Okay. Charged for cultivating chainas, right? So taxes had to be paid to the kings, okay, for cultivating chainas. Now, because the country was considered, like the whole land was considered property of the king, okay, right? Okay, that was how it all worked, the political system, right? So mainly now, if you are not in your house, you are planning to cultivate, or you're planning to use another land which is belong to the king for some cultivation or any purpose, you have to pay taxes, right? Simple as that. So these are the two types of taxes which were charged by people who cultivated channels. Khati ada and ketu kanaba aya. Look at these words, guys. Khati ada. Khati means, or khatta means khati. Used to cut these trees and clear these trees and everything. Khati, right? Khati ada. Ketu, ketu means you kotana, you know, you till, you are just tilling, you are just digging, something like that. Till, ketu kanaba aya. So these words are very, you know, if you go deep and understand the meaning, these are very simple to remember. Okay, so khati ada and ketu kanaba aya were two types of taxes mentioned in inscriptions. Okay, now this also says, the inscriptions say that, okay, we'll discuss that later, but I just want to touch on this. One king called King Nissankamalla abolished these two taxes during his ruling period. Okay, so this is also noteworthy. Okay, all right, so you can write two types of taxes charged. Khati ada and ketu kanaba were two types of taxes charged from people for cultivating channels.
Finished, sir.
All right, good. let's go to some more words, right, related to paddy cultivation. Now, kumbura and khetar. Kumbura means this is the paddy field, okay? Kumbura. Kumbura is used to call the small paddy field, okay? Kumbura. Khetar means the huge paddy fields, like the ones in Anuradhapura and Polonnaru. They are huge, right? They are called khetar. Kumbura, you go to Homagama, you go to Kottava, Panipitiya, those areas you can see kumburu, they are very small, okay, compared to those in Anuradhapura and Polonnaru, they are very small. Okay, so kumburu and khetar, those are like live examples right now, we can see them. Kumburu and khetar. Okay, so kumburu is a small paddy field, khetar is used to call big fields. Okay, then we have yalakanne, mahakanne and madakanne. Okay, three kannes. Yalakanne, mahakanne, madakanne. So yeah, the kanne means season, okay, where the paddy was cultivated. We have yalakanne, we have one kanne, yalakanne, mahakanne, okay, and madakanne, oh, mid season, madakanne, madakanne. Kanne means season, huh? So over here in the book it says kanna, kanna kiyanne plural, okay, kanna deka. Kanna means eating. Now, no, we use like that. No, I mean, even today, the words are being used by farmers. Okay, kanne. Ilan kanne. Me kanne vaga karno. Ilan kanne balum. Right. Normally use that. Okay. So now there were only two main kanne. So there were two main seasons. Okay. One is yala, one is maha. But if the water level is good, or if there was enough water to cultivate another season, they used to cultivate that season as well. That's called a madha season, madha kanne. Okay, so they will first, you know, cultivate yala and see if they have like enough water left in the tanks. Okay, so that water is enough to cultivate another season, mid season. Okay, they will go ahead and cultivate that season as well. Okay, that's called madakanne.
Sir, how yalakanne and mahakanne are different?
Two seasons, Buddha, in the year. It's like, you know, due to the monsoon rains, Rishigiri, who ruled the Jaffna regions, have this here. There are two cultivation seasons, namely Maha and Yala, which are synonymous with two monsoons. Okay. So Maha season falls during northeast from September to March, right? Yala is May to August. Got it?
So what is the definition for madakanne?
Madakanne means the intermediate season or the mid season. Okay, madakanne was cultivated when there was enough water. So that's what you need to remember. Okay, additional season or intermediate season. You can call it an additional season. okay, but Yala and Maha were the two main seasons. Okay, Madakanya was cultivated when there was enough water only, not all the time. Okay, Yala and Maha were the two main seasons. So not only farming, not only agriculture. Okay, they also were engaged in animal husbandry. Now I will explain all these right when I'm explaining. So when it comes to animal husbandry, this word is important. Kirigiri. There were cows specially reared to take milk, or milk cows. They are called kirigiri. Okay, kiri means milk, giri means cow. Okay. Kirigiri. So cattle means, you know, like groups of cows, you call them cattle. Okay. හරක බාන කියලා කියන්නේ අපි සිංහලෙන් cattle. So cows that were specially reared for milk, they were called kirigiri. Okay, there were different types of, like, I mean, cows. Okay, like some cows were reared for transport, some cows were reared for work in the paddy fields. Okay, they are not milk cows. Some cows were reared for milk only, but like, unlike these days, now you know, not in Sri Lanka, but in other countries, they rear cattle for beef, right? Especially there are farms that, you know, rear cows for meat. So we didn't have that practice. Okay, we mainly reared cattle for milk, transport, and also, you know, working. Like buffaloes, like to work in the paddy fields. Okay, so industries, there are many words under industries. To keep that for next week, right? And let's get this thing explained now, right? Okay. Before that, any questions from these words?
So can you give a definition for kirigiri?
Kirigiri, yeah. You want me to write it?
Okay, sir.
Right. Used to call cattle. Now, guys, when I'm telling you, it's time that you learn to construct small sentences like this. Okay, like, I mean, using your own words. Okay,
okay sir.
You can write getting here, getting milk, or obtaining, getting or obtaining, both words are okay. Okay, obtaining is a better word to use when you write. Getting is good when you are talking. Okay guys, so if you don't have any questions, let's go to the explanation part. Okay, so this shouldn't take a long time anyway. All right, so last week we learned about let me just brief you on what we've learned last week. Okay, any country has something called the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. Okay, so any administrative system in the world has these three parts. Okay, all right, what is executive? Executive is where the laws, where the decisions are taken to implement the laws. Legislature is where the laws are made, and judiciary or courts are basically institutions, you know, that hear cases related to breaking of laws. You can call it that way. Okay, so making laws, legislature. Judiciary is when the laws are broken, or, you know, what punishment, everything. Yeah, judiciary. Executive is where the decisions are being taken. Okay, all right. So now, in the ancient times, executive, you know, you can call all these three things in one place, like the king himself. Okay, so sometimes he was also the chief judge or chief justice. He was the one who made the rules. He was the one who decided whether to implement the rule or not. Okay, so it's like that. So mainly, you know, he had both the powers, like executive and legislative. He's the one who made the rules. He's the one who makes sure the rules are like implemented or the rules are put into action. Okay. So that is why we call these two together with a beautiful word. That is what? Yeah. What is that word? Ancient word? Used to call these two? Ektan Samya. Okay. All right. So then, judiciary, the word Sabhava comes into picture when it comes to the judiciary. Okay. Sabhava is also the council, and sometimes Sabhava can be called as judiciary. Okay. Why Sabhava is important? Why this Sabhava is important? Sabhava is a place where, you know, things are checked whether like as to whether the rules are followed or not. If the rules are broken, the punishments are decided, for example, like the judiciary, okay? The courts, basically, right? So let's say, for example, now if you are selling a land to somebody, okay? If you are selling a land to somebody, you have to go to a lawyer, okay, and get some papers signed, and they will send it to like somebody. Okay, if there's a problem involving that land, you have to go to the courts. Okay, similarly, Sabhava was the judiciary. That means if any land was given to somebody by the king or by decree, decree means, you know, the orders, right? So, you know, several procedures needed to be followed, not like, yeah, okay, the king said, okay. Give it to him. Give this. Right? You know, some people were given villages as gifts. Okay. They were called Nindagam. We learned that in chapter 8. So, Nindagam, right? Okay. Me gama oyata. Who's giving? The king is giving, right? So, the whole, like, for the service rendered to the king, right? But, even though the king told like that, it won't become like law. Okay. There is a procedure to follow. So the procedure was followed by Sabha, okay, or the judiciary, okay, where the documents were prepared, where the borders were marked, everything was done by the Sabha, okay, right. So this we need to understand very well. And also there were people, there was a senior officer called Mahalle or Mahalekam or Mahalekaka to take care of all the documents, okay, to take care of all the documents, who was basically in charge of all the documentation stuff. Right, and also preserving documents was his duty as well. Okay, so now look, when King Pandukabe, for example, made Anuradhapura city, Anuradhapura a city, and then Anuradhapura became a kingdom after that, right? So the kings used to rule the country while staying in the city. Okay, king can't go everywhere. Right, so you have to understand this very well. Okay, king cannot go everywhere, right? So the king appointed several officers or different officers to take care of different regions. Sometimes they were like provincial kings as well. So one such example is written in a golden plate called Vallipuram golden plate, right? So King Vasabha, there was a king called King Vasabha. He appointed a minister called, so the king was ruling the country for Anuradhapura. He can't go, you know, not like this. The communication, transport, everything was not that developed like it is today, right? I mean, for the king to like give a message to somebody, it might take 1 or 2 days, right? If it is like in somewhere like Hambantota or Anuradhapura or Hambantota, how a message will go? It might take days for the message to go, right? Okay, so it's not easy, right? Transportation and communication was not easy. Even if the king himself said, okay, I want to go to Magama. Magama is the Hambantota, the port, right? Old port, which was called Magama or Godavaya. So I want to go there, right? I want to kill somebody. I want to give a punishment. So king comes from there, like from Anuradhapura to Magama. It takes, you know, a long time, not like today, right? So because of that, the king appointed his representatives or his ministers or his regional rulers to take care of certain regions. Okay, so that means now the central government, or the main ruling center was Anuradhapura, but you know, because of the transportation systems and the communication was not developed, the king appointed, okay, trustworthy people like ministers and like regional rulers to take care of different regions. You have to understand that very well, okay? Right. Then also, not only that, the king didn't have time for hearing all the cases, right? So, Dasagammatha, no, the 10 heads of villages also had the power to get engaged or to involve in minor administrative affairs. Okay, Dasagammatha. One such example that they got involved is, now let's say now there are 10 villages. Okay, if there's any problem of giving dana to a temple, okay, if there are any problems or if there's any arrangements need to be done, those 10 heads of the villages got together, sat together and decided, okay, matters related to those things, right? So alms means dana. Okay, so if there was any problem regarding the offering of alms to temples, Dasagammatha should come and solve the problem, right? So that was mentioned in an inscription as well. The inscription called Kaludiya Pokuna in Mathale district. Okay, so that's extra knowledge for you guys, right? So let's talk about all the inscriptions mentioned in the in the book later. Okay, so some things that you have to remember, some things you can just simply ignore, right? I will tell you what. All right. And not only that, guys, now when a ruler is ruling the country, people have to be healthy, right? I mean, people need food to eat, people need clothes to wear, people need houses to stay. Okay, they were provided by themselves. People used to grow their own food and everything, so no worries. But the king also had to make sure the people are living a standard life. So people get ill, so to treat them, they built hospitals. Okay, so they were called health facilities or hospitals. They were called vejjashala. Okay, vejjashala. So vejja was used to call doctors. One king is very important when it comes to building hospitals in Sri Lanka. He was King Buddhadas. Okay, King Buddhadas. I still remember, I read a lot about King Buddhadasa those days. You guys just can, you know, Google it and see about King Buddhadasa. He really did a great service to build hospitals in Sri Lanka, especially, you know, lot of surgery tools and everything, you know, like were used during his time as well. Okay, so you can learn about that technology which existed. I mean, the medical technology and the medical how developed the medicine or medical system was in Sri Lanka. Okay, so vejjashala was used to name hospitals, and King Buddhadasa is a pioneer in building hospitals in Sri Lanka. Okay, all right. And there were several kings like King Buddhadasa, King Mahinda the fifth, and also King Kashyapa the fourth. Okay, so remember the names of these three kings who provided or who rendered a great service to the healthcare industry or to in building health facilities in Sri Lanka. Okay, all right. So now when it comes to Upasagaroganasa, now this is a specialist hospital built by King Kashyapa the fourth. Okay, why? Because, you know, right now we are going through a pandemic, same like that, a dangerous fever spread during King Kashyapa the fourth time in Anuradhapura. Okay, so that is why he built a hospital called Upasagaroganasa, because normal hospitals like, you know, the vejjashalas were not able to treat those patients, the facilities were not enough. So he decided to build specialist hospital or special hospital called Upasagaroganasa. Okay, who's the king? King Kashyapa the fourth, right? Remember the name. Okay, King Kashyapa the fourth. Right, so King Upatissa one is the one who pioneered in building hospitals dedicated for pregnant women. Okay, they were called Paswantinama Sala. Paswantinama Sala, right? So the meaning of Paswantinama Sala means hall. Sala means halls, okay? Halls built for the delivery. Halls built for delivery, delivering babies, right? So that's called Paswantinama Sala, built by King Upatis I as maternity hospitals, okay? So Thibirige is also a word that is used to call maternity hospitals. And Sottisala is also another word used to call maternity hospitals. But Sottisala is also a word that is used by Brahmins to call their call the halls that were used by them for religious activities. Okay, so this you have to remember very well. All right, so now let's talk a little bit about the relationships that Sri Lankan kings had with other countries. Okay, a little bit of that. Mainly our neighbor is India, so we had a very healthy relationship with India. From time to time we faced invasions. True, that's due to political reasons, okay? Due to different political reasons and different political stances, we had to face invasions. Some invasions, we managed to defeat. Some invasions, we basically got destroyed, okay? So, but yeah, from time to time, we were able to fight and defeat those invasions, fighting for years and years. And that is because, the unity within the country. When the country is united, when all the people in the country are united, yes, you can defeat any, foreign power, okay? Foreign intervention, right? So if any invasion is coming from other countries, yeah, they might win at the first stage, but with time, you get organized and you can defeat them, right? This we have proven over the years. That's about invasions. But here we are talking about the healthy relationships maintained by our kings with other countries, okay? One such example is King Gajabahu I. King Gajabahu I, he visited a state called the Chera state in South India. He was invited, basically. He went there to participate in a Pattini Devala opening ceremony. Okay, so that means Indian kings invited our kings for their occasions. Okay, so this is a very good example, right, for healthy relationships with neighboring countries. King Gajabahu I, okay, King Gajabahu the I. Right, so and also King Bhatigabe. King Bhatigabe is somebody who maintained or established relationships with European countries. Okay, Romanuka Desha, Europe, or Rome. Right, so he established relationship with Rome. He sent some people over there to get some glass pebbles for a puja performed at Ruanveli Saya. Now, Ruanveli Saya needed to be decorated with glass pebbles. So he sent a group or a team from Sri Lanka to Rome to get those glass pebbles. Right? So that's a good example of relationship with between Rome and Sri Lanka. Okay? Right. Then also China and Sri Lanka. China and Sri Lanka also used to have very good relationship. Right, so King Agabodhi the VI, let's take the notes later, just remember the names now for now. Right, King Agabodhi the VI, during the time of him, 20 missions were sent, 20 groups of representatives were sent to China, basically for trading, okay, business related activities. Okay, so this is very important. And also, from time to time, Sri Lanka also maintained marital relations with other countries, especially India. Okay, one example is King Vijayabahu I marrying an Indian prince or a Kalinga prince. Kalinga was a kingdom in India called Tiloka Sundari. Okay, Tiloka Sundari. So he married Tiloka Sundari. That is mainly to strengthen the relationship between the Kalinga kingdom and Sri Lanka, no, Anuradhapura, Polonnaruwa kingdom. Okay, Sri Lanka and India. Basically, a kingdom in India. There was no India those days. There was different kingdoms, right? Okay. So, and not only that, the king's sister, King Vijayabahuan's sister, who was called Princess Mitta, married a Pandyan prince. Okay, married a Pandyan prince. That is also, once again, we can understand that through marital relationships, we were able to strengthen political power in our country. Okay, so now let's say, for example, Kalinga, right? Kalinga kingdom in India. Okay, now their king changed. Now this king is very powerful and he thinks that, okay, Sri Lanka should be our province. We are going to invade Sri Lanka. But again, King Vijayabahu one is married to a princess from Kalinga. So because of that, the relationships are good. Now, normally you can't go and invade like that because the queen is also a Kalinga princess, right? So because of that, those invasion attempts were also thwarted. Basically, they also didn't happen. Why? Because the relationships were very good. Okay. So again, King Vijayabahuan's sister, Princess Mitta, was also married, got married to a Pandyan prince. So Pandya Deshe, Pandya Kingdom. State of Pandya or Pandya Kingdom also had good relationships at that time with our country. Okay, so that is mainly to establish political stability, you know, no invasions happen, no hostilities, no wars. You know, when you marry from another state, the relationships become very strong. Why? Because their relatives, you know, the queen's relatives will come from India to Sri Lanka. They will spend, you know, time in Anuradhapura or Polonnaruwa. And our king's relatives will go there, pay visits. And that is how these relationships grew. Okay. That is how, you know, we also have a lot of influence from other cultures. Okay. You know, we have a lot of influence from the Indian culture, right? That is a result of, you know, these kings marrying princesses from India. Okay. And not only that, look at this. There were mercenaries. Okay. There were mercenaries who were mainly paid soldiers. Okay. Paid soldiers. We call them mercenaries. So there were mercenaries who worked for Sri Lankan king who were basically Indians. One such mercenary group was called Velaikkar Force. Velaikkar Force. Velaikkar Force or Velaikkar Army, right? So they were mercenary army who worked for salaries, okay? Right? So that army was appointed by King Vijayabahu I to protect the temple tooth or Dalada Maligava in Polonnaruwa. Dalada Maligava was in Polonnaruwa at that time, okay? Not in Kandy. So he appointed this army from South India. Yeah, from South India, who basically worked for a salary, he appointed this army to protect Dalada Maligava or Temple of the Two, right? What can you understand from this? Okay, tell me what you can understand. Who can tell me? King Vijayabahu I appointing Velaikkar army who were basically paid soldiers from South India to protect Temple of the Two, Dalada Maligava. What can you understand from this? Tell me, Puta. Who can tell me?
Trust between the king and the Indian army.
Yeah, exactly. Trust that the king placed on Indian soldiers, right? The trust. Yeah, high level of trust. You know, those days, Dalada Karandu was considered, it is even today, the most sacred thing for Sri Lankans, right? The most sacred thing the Sri Lankans have today is the Dalada Karandu. So whoever possesses that, whoever had that in their possession, eka aitikaatada, he was considered the king. Okay, let's say for example, if there were battles between two princes, right, for the kingship, whoever possesses the dalada karandua or dalada sacred tooth relic was considered the king. So imagine King Vijayabahu I placing that under, you know, soldiers from South India. How much trust he would have kept on there, right? So that is the relationship we can talk about between the Sri Lankans and Indians. Okay, right. So not only that, we also had very good relationships with Arabian countries. Okay, Arabian countries, because you know, after the 10th century, after 9th century, 10th century, Arabians started doing a lot of business in this region. I mean, they became very good traders. Before that, they were engaging in different, you know, wars and everything in Arabia. After that, they became traders, very good traders, and they became like the link between the Asia and Europe. So they used to come to our country, India, and Far East, other countries, and buy spices and go to Europe and sell them. Okay. So because of that, our relationships with the Arabs also grew, Arab traders especially, right? So the Arabs used to call this as Serendip those days. And Arabians also called Sri Lanka as the Ruby Island. Okay, Ruby Island. So they mainly came for gems. They mainly came for that. Okay, we didn't have tea those days. So now the Arabs enjoy our tea, Ceylon tea. They really love Ceylon tea. But those days they loved our gems, right? So we had a lot of gems. So ruby is a type of gem, right? Ratukata. That is how Sri Lankan kings also maintained very good relationships with the Arabian kings. Okay. All right. So next week you can discuss about farming and agriculture. Before that, I will make sure you get the notes for this, right? Summarized notes. But I want you guys to try making mind maps, right? That is a very good way to learn. Okay. But over here in this chapter, we have a lot of singular words, ancient words that you have to remember. Understand the purpose of teaching this lesson very well. Okay. Right. So you know that the economy was mainly based on agriculture in Sri Lanka. Okay. So there were two forms of agriculture, like cultivation. One is the chaina cultivation, the other one is the paddy field cultivation. Chaina cultivation, which was also called highland cultivation. Mainly, you know, the land is dry in chaina cultivation. Mainly you are cultivating jungles. That is called chaina cultivation. Wetland cultivation or paddy field cultivation is mainly you are like growing paddy in muddy lands, okay, or which is also called wetlands, okay, wetland cultivation. Okay, so those are the two types of cultivation when it comes to agriculture. In addition to that, animal husbandry was also performed by people. And what is animal husbandry? Mainly rearing animals for agricultural, or they are, you know, mainly to fulfill the needs of people. That's called animal husbandry. Okay, so those days there were no animal husbandry during the prehistoric era. No, so mainly, you know, they used to hunt animals and eat, right? So later they discovered, okay, you can rear chicken so that you can also get eggs from them, you can get meat from the chicken. So it's, yeah, that became like a way of life. That's animal husband. And they reared cattle. Rearing means growing, breeding, rearing, looking after. That's called rearing. Okay, so they reared cattle. So by rearing cattle, they can also take work from them. They can also use cattle means cows basically. So they can use the cows for transport and also in the agricultural activities, and also you can get milk from them. Okay, so that is why they reared cattle. Not only cattle, they also reared goats, chicken, like, you know, poultry. Okay, so let's discuss about China cultivation and paddy field cultivation a little in detail next week. And also, any questions from today's lesson, guys?
No, sir.
All right. So remember what I told you. Page number 45. The figure is very important. Okay. And also all the words that we learned today. We'll have a short question and answer session next week to check whether you can remember all these words. Okay. Page number 52. Mark the page and keep. Keep a bookmark or something there. Okay. Very important. And also page number 18. There's a map. That's also so important. Page number 11 also important. Page number 11 is about prehistoric settlements. Page number 18 is about proto-historic settlements. Page number 52 is about the ancient cities, rivers, and commercial cities in the country. If you don't have questions, I'll see you next week. Take care, guys. God bless you all.
God bless you, sir. Good night, sir.
Thank you. Good night. See you. Take care. Bye. Bye.